Steve Bowers and
Sandra Fuller,
welcoming you to Six in the City. Got a busy week coming. We had a four-hour marathon county commission meeting yesterday. It's going to be replayed.
Yes,
we Friday do. Night we will be away. We have Cincinnati Reds baseball coming up a lot this week, and so we'll be into all that. We'll run down through that at the end of the show. But Cassandra, we got a lot of folks with us today.
We
got a lot of special things to talk about. Not as many guests.
That's
but a lot
right.
Of things to discuss.
That's right. And first up on our list, we have Matt Marshall, who's president and CEO of United Way of West Tennessee. They've got a gently used device drive that's going on and continuing, and want to get the word out to gather some devices. And then from Make-A-Wish Mid-South, we have Amanda Wigg. She's marketing director. She's going to talk to us about some Make-A-Wish events coming up. And then we're going to talk to Jeremy Tubbs, who is Jeremy and Jenna McLean, who are with the U of M Lambuth music program. Jenna's new to the faculty there, and Jeremy is president of the Jackson Area Music Society. So we're going to get a couple of segments with them to talk a little bit about music and what's going on. And then executive director of the Jackson-Madison County Airport Authority, McKellar Sykes, is Steve Smith. He's going to be with us to talk to us about, just give us an update on the airport, the service, how COVID has impacted the flights and things like that. And then we're actually going to get music from Jeremy Tubbs and Jenna McLean. So it should be an exciting show today.
It'll be a full show today. A lot of things to do, so stay right where you are. We're back with more as we continue. Six in the City.
It's still hard to think that your child had cancer. The thought of them not being here, it was terrifying.
Going through treatment for cancer can be quite difficult for patients. That's why platelets are so vital.
When he would get the platelets, he would perk right up. Just so thankful that somebody had taken the time out of their day to donate platelets.
Please help give them hope and the strength to carry on. Donate platelets.
Doing what's never been done. The American Public Power Association includes over 2,000 local public utility systems. Over 15 years, the APPA has presented RP3 awards, recognizing system reliability, safety, workforce development, and improvement. JA in 2020 not only received the top-level Diamond RP3 award, it was presented to JA for the seventh time. No utility has been so recognized. Honored Public Power, another part of JA Today.
Today, I'm going to talk to you about physics. Come on in, girls. Let's go. This is the first rocket to get humans to Mars.
Really tall.
I'm a rocket structural engineer, designing and building parts of the rocket. You are the generation that will be stepping foot on Mars. Do I have a group of astronauts on my hands?
Yes.
You can become a rocket scientist or whatever else you want to be.
Welcome back to Six in the City. Matt Marshall is with us. He, among many things in this life, is executive director of the United Way. And they have what they're calling a gently used device drive. And so, what are we talking about here with devices?
Yeah, so as you guys know, as our audience knows, COVID-19 has presented a number of challenges. One of those is in our school systems with kids being able or really rather not being able to go into normal sessions. And so many of them having to take classes virtually, from home. But the issue that we run into, we've seen two main problems. Some people don't have internet access. Other people, they may have, one piece, but they don't have the other, and they might not have devices that can actually be used for this purpose. And so you guys will probably know, we partnered with the Jackson-Madison County School System a few weeks ago to provide hotspot devices for several families. Now we're, reaching back out to the community, asking people if they have gently used devices that they'd be willing to donate, that they would do so that students might be able to access those virtual classrooms.
So what are those, man?
Yeah, so they can be iPads or tablets or smartphones gently used Chromebooks or laptops. Anything like that someone might have that they're no longer using and they'd be willing to donate, we would be happy to take and wipe and again put those in the hands of a student who might have need.
Okay. So how will you collect those and distribute those?
So we're taking donations right now, specifically in the Jackson community here at our office at 470 North Parkway, but also you can drop those off at RIFA downtown. And if you're in other communities, there are a handful of other places that you can also donate those. So places like McKenzie Carroll United Neighbors up in McKenzie, Tennessee, or Jesus Cares down in Selmer. And so, you know, there's a number of places that you can do that. And again, our main purpose is just trying to get these devices into the hands of students that have need so that they can continue, you know, even despite the pandemic, being able to learn.
And are those locations listed on United Way's website?
Yes. They're listed on our United Way's website. They're also listed on all of our social media. And so you can go on our Facebook page and you can see, we post about it almost every single day. And so you can see all of the locations where you can drop off devices.
What about those people who have the devices but are a little hesitant because of security or, you know, information that's mm-hmm. actually on the device that they haven't gotten, that they haven't wiped off yet?
Sure. And so, yes, I would ask everyone before they turn them in, if possible, to factory reset them. And so to do so, they can just go in their settings and factory reset or wipe those devices. But before we distribute them to anyone, we're making sure that, you know, we'll do that again and that those devices will be wiped and have a clean slate before they're put in anyone's hands.
Matt, how extensive is this need?
It's pretty widespread. You know, one thing that we didn't really take into consideration, and I mean this as a culture, as a society, as a nation, is that, you know, as we entered into the fall and, you know, we had to make these decisions about whether kids could go back to school or not, once many districts, and most of them did, made this decision to do virtual learning and to do distance learning, you know, many of our districts, none of our districts really, were equipped for that process. And so to have the devices that they needed, many of them didn't have those. And so, you know, thankfully the federal government and the state government did send down money for this type of purpose. However, what we've seen is that, you know, those orders, you know, are very large orders. So think about, you know, in a district like Madison County, as an example, where there's 12,000 students, over 12,000 students, many of which are doing virtual learning. They had to put in a big order for that. But let's remember, so did every other district in the country. And so now all of a sudden you have all, you know, literally hundreds of districts across the country all putting in large orders for the same devices. And so we've seen that cause this backlog where even our local districts have not been able to get those devices as quickly as they would have liked. And so every single day that goes by where a child doesn't have access, they're losing ground.
How do you then distribute these when you get?
Yeah, so we have worked with several of those districts. We've been in contact with them and we've asked them what they need. And so we've had that conversation with them. Many of them have taken surveys of their communities and of their families. And so they have a log and a list of families with those specific needs. And then so we coordinate directly with the school systems to make sure that it's the families who need it the most that are getting them. And so, you know, thankfully, we're also in the process over the next several weeks of United Way partnering together with these districts in other ways. And so some of that will be providing other types of technology for them through Tennessee Cares money and funding such as that. So we're doing that and we're keeping in contact with them to try to figure out, again, who has the greatest need and how can we supply that.
United Way of West Tennessee, check it on Facebook and on their webpage as well. And yes. The gently used device drive is underway.
That's right.
Matt, appreciate it so very much. Good to see you.
Thanks so much,
good
Matt.
To see you.
Good to see you.
Have you back
soon.
We're going to talk about Make-A-Wish. We'll do that next as we continue. Six in the City.
I'm Mark Taylor. I'm the owner of Renew Biomedical Services based out of here in Jackson, Tennessee. We're a provider of biomedical services for medical professionals. At Renew Biomedical, our use of telecom is of utmost importance. We have to reach our customers in a timely fashion so we can diagnose and service their equipment needs. So EPlus broadband allows Renew Biomedical to connect effectively with our customers in whichever way they choose, via email, phone, Skype, teleconferencing, in any way you can imagine.
Need to check your bill balance? Set a payment extension. Get outage notifications. With JEA, it's easy. Text. When you enroll in JA Alerts, you open all those possibilities. To enroll, text JOIN, J-O-I-N, to 53248. Text JOIN to 53248. If your cell phone number is current, two-way texting is yours. Real-time communication, direct customer service with JEA today.
Say it and see it with voice control. Find your favorites faster across live, recorded, and streaming TV. Movies, shows, news, sports, music are just a voice command away. Show me action movies. Just for kids. Every result personalized based on viewing habits and time of day. Say it, watch it. It's that easy with the power of voice control.
Welcome back to Six in the City, and we're delighted to welcome Make-A-Wish with us. Amanda Wigg is with us with the Make-A-Wish Mid-South office. Amanda, good to see you and good to have you with us.
Good afternoon. Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here.
Make-A-Wish has provided many special moments. We've had some on this show down through the years, and they've been special and very emotional and telling and rewarding moments. And so, you know, Make-A-Wish does magic work. You say there's several wishes being granted in the Jackson area, our needs for wishes to be granted. We're looking for funding to help support that.
That's exactly right. Right now in the Jackson area, there are 39 kids who are looking for funding to make their wishes come true. And what a lot of people are unfamiliar with is that the funding for wishes actually comes from people just like us. You know, it comes from individuals, from corporations, from schools. And we are really eager to get these wishes granted for kiddos who have been waiting.
Okay, wow. How do you comprise that list or get on that list?
Sure. So a wish starts with a referral. Any child with a critical illness can be eligible for a wish. You can just give our office a call or go to our website, midsouth.wish.org, to start the referral process. We just confirm with the child's medical professional about that child's condition. And then from there, you get a wish. There's absolutely no cost to the family, nothing else to it. It's a really simple process to refer a child. And we are always eager to grant wishes to every child in Jackson and across West Tennessee with any critical illness.
But we have 39 right now, you say 39. Wow.
That's right. Amanda, waiting on their wishes.
Amanda, what funding does it take to grant those wishes to each individual child? What amount of funding does?
Right. The average cost of a wish is actually close to $10,000. Mm-hmm. And wishes span, we're actually still granting so many wishes right now. We're not doing travel wishes like we had in the past. Of course, none of us are traveling right now, but we are granting a lot of she shed wishes, playground wishes, pool wishes. A wish kid, Lana in Jackson here, she recently wished for a computer and a color printer to stay connected to her classmates and to continue learning as school went virtual. And she could not be more thrilled about that computer. It was really sweet to see her so excited to have that wish granted.
Oh, wow. That's great. Of all the things that she could wish for, and she wishes for a computer so she could stay connected. That's really
yes.
Cool. How do you go about publicizing the need here? Of course, this is one way of doing it, I guess. But
and this is absolutely one way of doing it. We're really grateful to have a number of people on our board in Jackson, Tennessee, and they kind of are outreaching to their own communities. We're really grateful to be on shows like this and other shows in the Jackson community. We also have volunteers in Jackson. So the way wishes work is when a wish child is referred and then eligible for a wish, our volunteers go to meet with that child and his or her family, talk about what they like and what they want to be when they grow up. And they actually kind of walk that family through the wish process until the wish is granted. And so we're really grateful to have a number of wonderful volunteers in the Jackson area.
If somebody is interested in providing funding or being a sponsor of Make-A-Wish, how do they go about doing that, Amanda?
Absolutely. We would so invite you guys and anybody to get involved. We're really grateful for all of our sponsors and all of our funding. It's so important to our mission. It's how wishes are granted. You can start the process midsouth.wish.org. Make-A-Wish is actually a local organization. So here in Jackson, we're our own 501c3. Although it's a national organization, we raise money locally, and the money raised locally stays in this community, which is really incredible. So our Facebook page, Make-A-Wish Mid-South, Instagram, I'll have a lot of information to get involved, but can start with our website or give us a call, and we'd be so thrilled to connect with anybody wanting to get involved.
You've got an annual drive that's coming up. Is that information on that website as well?
Yes, it is. So that's Season of Wishes. It's our annual campaign coming up, and we are so excited about it. It's a really, it's a widespread campaign that's able to grant a lot of wishes. That's kicking off in November. So you can stay tuned, and I'll be happy to come back with more information on that soon.
We'd love to have you back.
Certainly do. Amanda, thank you so much. Appreciate the work that is being done and all the effort of the volunteers and contributors to this. And it does brighten a light up here. Certainly does. Thanks, Amanda, for sharing the time.
Thank you.
We're going to the main stage, as we call it. Jeremy Tubbs is with us and Jenna McLean with us. And we'll be talking to them coming up in the next segment of the show. But we're going to get out of the way and let them play and sing. Jeremy.
You by the house of fun. I don't know why I didn't come. I don't know why I didn't come. When I saw the break of day, I wish that I could fly away. Instead of kneeling in the sand, catching teardrops in my hand. My heart is drenched in wine, but you'll be on my mind forever. I would cross the endless sea, to see, but I'll be a bag of bones driving down the road alone. My heart is drenched in wine, but you
EPlus broadband and watch TV everywhere. You can now take your TV on the go. Just visit watchtveverywhere.com to sign up. Then you're all set to catch your favorite shows, movies, and sports wherever and whenever you want on any internet-connected device. Choose from our growing selection of networks from your cable package at no extra charge. Visit watchtveverywhere.com to learn more. It's easy to sign up for EPlus broadband's TV everywhere.
Want to receive account information via text? When you enroll in JA Alerts, you can. Text to get a bill balance, due date, set a payment extension, receive an outage notification, reply to report an electric outage. Text JOIN, J-O-I-N, text JOIN to 53248, 53248. Cell phone number must be current and attached to your JA account. Visit jacksenergy.com/textalerts for more information.
Here at the Emergency Operations Center, we rely on EPlus Broadband Fiber Network to better serve Madison County. With high-speed internet, we track storms and natural disasters in real time. Also, fiber internet gives us the speed to host training classes preparing responders from all over the county and state. The phone system allows us flexibility to stay in contact and make conference calls with both in and out of the office with local, state, and federal agencies. Connectivity is an important part of emergency management.
Welcome back to Six in the City. Steve Bowers and Cassandra Fuller with you. And we continue the presence of Jeremy Tubbs and Jenna McLean. And Jenna, what a debut. That's great.
Thank you.
Yeah. Glad to have you. So you have joined the faculty at the University of Memphis Lambeth?
I have.
Okay.
I've been here for 2 months.
2 months. All right. From where did you come?
I came from Colorado, Northern Colorado. I was at the University of Northern Colorado working on my doctorate in jazz studies, and I'm still working on that, but nearly finished. So grateful to be working here.
Well, I'll tell you, you weren't just driving down the interstate and saw a help wanted sign. So
it was in the plan.
How did you connect with the University of Memphis Lambeth?
Well, I was searching for college teaching jobs in general. And so I found this one way back maybe in the fall semester. And then everything happened with COVID. And so I think there was a hiring freeze and then they unfroze. And so, Jeremy gave me a call and we worked it out from there. And yeah.
Wow. So Jeremy, what are you looking to do then with this first expansion of faculty we've had really? Or?
Yeah, Steve, we're in some pretty interesting times at the University of Memphis Lambeth campus. We're doing some, we're looking at progress. We're looking at what comes next. What do we do next? And Jenna was the next step to that. We are looking forward to building on that. And there's some exciting things coming out, not only just with us, with the music department, but with also the university there in, you know, in at Lambeth. So,
okay. All right.
So we're just building basically.
Okay. Well, that's when you're looking at it as head of that department, then what does Jenna represent to you or bring to this?
Jenna brings, one, a freshness. Two, she's working with our vocal students and our piano students, something that I don't really, that's not my specialty. Being a musicologist and music technology is more my specialty. So I'm more history and technology, and she's more theory and voice and piano and jazz. So it's we're just adding another element to make the puzzle pieces, you know, look more clearer. You know, it looks like we have, you know, in the future, the landscape is, you know, night and day. And to me, she brings in something I can't do to help me and help the students actually.
Okay. Jenna, did you want to get into teaching? Was that a career objective, or is this an unexpected development?
It's been a career objective pretty much since I went into grad school as a music student. So I've always been very fully invested in being a performer and writing songs and all that good stuff. But I also love to teach and love to contribute to music in that way too. So, yeah.
Well, one other thing I want to ask then, of course, if COVID has affected anything, from what I read and people to whom I talk, musicians have caught the brunt of a lot of this, just the nature of the work, venues that are closed down, tours that are canceled, and everything else. And so, you know, there are many people that were thriving musicians a few months ago that have basically been unemployed for the last several months.
I have, Steve, you know, I have a lot of friends that work in the music industry, and a lot of them are sidelined right now. They don't have their tours going on. There's a lot of aware, I guess, need of awareness that these musicians, a lot of them, even though some are, you know, can last a year or two without touring, most cannot.
Right.
So I think from this pandemic, we're going to learn a lot about art. There's a lot of things that are going to happen, you know, afterwards that, you know, we're going to learn about artistically. You know, people do, what have they been doing, you know? So
in the midst of this, it's been interesting to see that the enrollment at the University of Memphis Lambeth has gone up, what, 23-25% this year?
That's right, 23%.
Okay.
Yeah. And that's because we have been working hard to, you know, to recruit and to get students on campus in some, either virtually or on campus, hopefully a little bit later. And so I give credit to, you know, Dr. Reddick and the admissions and people in the community who, you know, are recruiting and working hard to make sure that we have curriculum in place and professors in classrooms, you know.
Okay. So Jenna, then you've come to campus in a couple of months, and so you're plugged into the curriculum now.
I am, yes, yep. Okay. And I've been teaching some things remotely, and private lessons are a little bit more flexible and unique as it's one-on-one. So yeah, plugged right in right away. And so yeah, starting a new job, but also starting it in a strange way.
Well, we're going to continue this conversation in just a moment, but we want to get out of the way, as we say, go back to the main state to let these people do what they do best. This is Jeremy Tubbs and Jenna McLean.
Sky, vast is the sky, with faraway clouds just wandering by. Where do they go? I just don't know. Wind that speaks to the leaves, telling stories that no one believes. Stories of love belong to you and me. Oh, didn't if I only had words, I would say all the beautiful things that I see when you're with me, oh my Ginger. Don't you know, Ginger, like the song of the wind in the trees, that's how my heart is singing. Happy Gingy, when you're with me. I love you more each day. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. I let you go away if you take me with you. Don't you know, Ginger, I'd go running and searching for you like a river that can't find us. That would be me without you, Ginger. No.
For the most reliable drinking water supply at the highest quality, reach for the tap. Our tap water is safe and continues to exceed all government requirements. For more information about our drinking water, visit www.jacksenergy.com/JEACCR.
Move over. It's the law. When approaching work vehicles or crews, move over to create a safety zone. It protects utility workers, law enforcement, firefighters, and emergency personnel. It's not an option. Slow down. It could save a life. Stay safe. Move over.
Hi, I'm Kedrick Perkins, PGA General Manager at Jackson Country Club. Jackson Country Club's amenities are true Southern hospitality. Championship golf course, fine dining, 6 tennis courts, Junior Olympic pool and fitness. We pride ourselves in giving our members the best. Choosing JEA was a logical choice so that we could tie in our phone, internet, and cable solutions so that we can advance our next segment of technology.
I knew it hurt her.
My heart broke in half, and I felt like I was about as close to losing her as I was gonna get.
In active addiction, you don't know what's going on. What I thought about was the little girl with the pageant dress on. I knew that I wasn't supposed to be doing these things. There is hope.
She found inside herself that she's way better than that, and she rose from it.
Jeremy Tubbs and Jenna McLean are with us, and they are the part of the faculty at the University of Memphis Lambuth and the music program there, which, Jeremy, it was Music Industries at one time. It is entitled what now?
So, yeah, when it was at Lambuth, it was called Entertainment Music Industry, EMI is what kind of everybody shortened it to. And now it's Music and Entertainment, and it is a Bachelor of Professional Studies
Okay. All right. So what all does it include then?
It has three areas of study. We do a kind of an industry side, which has also music business. So technology, recording, songwriting, music services, how music industry, our music labels work, how touring works, all that part of the music industry. We also have a music aspect, a real kind of traditional aspect where they take music history, rock and roll history, music in America, music theory 1 and 2, some ear training. Then they have to also have semesters of private lessons in either piano, voice, or guitar, and drums, actually, too. Okay. And then there's the third part is they get a strict business. So there's 18 hours of business courses.
Okay.
So marketing, managing, organization, all that stuff.
So Jenna, then you'll be doing the voice and piano. Is that right?
Voice and piano, private lessons. And then I'm also teaching music theory and intro to music for non-majors.
Well, since you mentioned jazz, one thing, it's like when you get around blues musicians, everybody says, well, this is blues. And it's like, well, you could have fooled me because it just covers the gamut out there. And I sense the same thing in jazz. What is jazz when you define it?
That's a great question. I think it's a complicated genre that covers a lot of different styles, really. But simply put, I would say it's improvised, like it's heavily improvised music a lot of the time.
It's a good thing they know where they are because I don't, but they all begin and end at the same time, right? And it's amazing how they get there, right?
Everybody.
But then there are other times that what they call jazz is kind of like standard, what I consider kind of standard classic song, with which I'm familiar.
Right. Like a lot of what I do, I sing a lot of songs from the Great American Songbook that were, show tunes way back when in the 30s and 40s. But have put a fresh spin on them by a lot of different artists at this point. Jazz musicians generally will follow the form of a well-known tune like that from the Great American Songbook or from one of our great jazz composers. And everybody knows what the form is, and so they're able to freely improvise and communicate that way.
It's just playing off the page, I guess, like Jeremy, whatever that is.
Yeah, I mean, the fake books, we call it fake books because it's a book full of songs usually written by professional songwriters that were either meant for the Broadway stage or meant for the film stage, and they've been adapted over the years. It all comes from our great American tradition of writing songs. I mean, we are, American music is deeply rooted in the song. The song is extremely important. It's been like that for 150 to almost 200 years. We can go back to even Yankee Doodle, back and talking about things like that. But yes, Stephen Foster in the 1840s and 50s, going into, the turn of the century and the Industrial Revolution, and then the rise of the American Songbook, which it's directly related to Broadway and film. I mean, that's the standard.
How do you then develop pockets? Because I know New Orleans, people say they associate jazz with New Orleans, but then I was out in Kansas City last couple of years, and they lay claim to this, And I thought, well, how do you get these pockets out here where people say, well, this is the place where this is really done, and done well?
Right, a lot of people credit New Orleans to being the birthplace of jazz, and that's due to a lot of things, but its central location, just as a trade port, and then Kansas.
Yeah, see, the countdown. What I would think, right? We're a jazz city. What we are, right?
Right. Yeah. So there are several, major cities that are central hubs of it all, and they kind of developed.
We also have to remember that jazz is also, it didn't start out as a very elitist form of music.
It did not, right?
No, it didn't.
And that jazz was considered bawdy and dirty and filthy, actually. So New Orleans had that kind of reputation there, especially in the Storyville area that used to be the kind of the bordellos and the bars and the clubs and the gambling and all that stuff. That's where jazz, really originated from.
It becomes part of the establishment, as did rock and roll, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, rock and roll. And, that's the reason why Memphis
kind of plays that. Right. Yeah, now it's art form, Well, it's really good to, Jenna, good to have you in this city. We really appreciate it.
Glad you made
the choice to be here. It's exciting. So we look forward. Have you got a name for this, working name for this group yet?
No, not yet. We're just, this is new to. I mean, we haven't been able to get with students, and so we're putting stuff together as well. And so when this was offered, I thought it'd be a great opportunity to kind of get something started, you know?
Yeah. Well, great. We hope y'all come back and do a Studio 6 with us. Yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah. It's great. Well, continued best. And if people want to know more about the music program, University of Memphis Lambeth, what's the best way to do that?
Yeah, the best way is just to go to the website and click on the links that lead to want more information. It goes directly usually to me. But again, we have wonderful admissions people who will direct as well. So you can always just call the school or go to the website, memphis.edu. It's real quick. It's real simple.
Well, Fritz Zucker and all those guys that got on the limb to help start that at Lambuth University, it's great to see that it continued here.
It's thriving, yes.
That's great to hear. And congratulations to the university. And once again, 23% increase in enrollment and change the midsection of this city, save the midsection of the city in that sense. And it means a lot to Jackson. We're glad you are here.
Thanks, Steve, very much.
Appreciate it. We're going to come back and talk to Steve Smith, another important guy in our community. We're talking about McKellar Site Regional Airport and everything that goes with it as we continue Six in the City.
The SOAR Award, System Operational Achievement Recognition, presented by the American Public Gas Association, recognizes forward-thinking natural gas utilities that continually improve operation capabilities, adapt to challenges, and the changing demands of safe, reliable natural gas distribution. In 2019, the APGA Gold SOAR Award was presented to the Natural Gas Division of JEA. System integrity, forward-thinking innovation, all a real part of JEA today.
At Southern Family Dentistry, we offer dental treatment for your entire family. We have the latest 3D digital x-ray system. We offer implants, veneers, teeth whitening, and all the other normal services you receive at the dental office. We have two offices, one in Milan and one in Jackson, and EPlus broadband telephone services allows us to connect both of those offices. It doesn't matter which office the patient calls, we have the ability to speak to that patient at either location.
Experience something new with ViewIt Video On Demand. Now you can preview and rent movies with your remote. Press the TiVo button to go to the home screen. Select ViewIt On Demand to get started. Browse new movie releases and events. Select what you want to watch, then rent. There's even free stuff. You'll find karaoke songs, fun screensaver for your TV, videos for the kids, and more. Experience more with TiVo and ViewIt Video On Demand.
Welcome back to Six in the City, and we will hear more from Jeremy Tubbs and Jenna McLean, and we're delighted to have them on with us.
Boy, her voice is just
is
so
it not perfect?
Oh, my goodness. Wow. I could listen to it all day.
You know, some people could sing, and then people can sing, you know.
That's right.
Steve Smith is with us. He is the executive director of the Jackson-Madison County Airport Authority, McKellar Sites Regional Airport, and all the environs that go with that. Steve's good to see you.
Hey, good to see you guys.
I understand there are many different things happening at the airport. Of course, we've been focused on Air Choice One and COVID impact. And are people still traveling? Is the airline doing well? Are they happy here? And are they going to continue? Where do we stand with all that?
That's a lot of questions.
Yeah, it is.
he just unloaded the dump truck on you there.
Oh, I'm telling you, he did. Hey, let me get my pencil out. Let's start with this. It looks like that after the initial downturn in the COVID-19, air travel came back out here at about 30% of its original where we were. We were running about 1,200 passengers a month. Now it's up to about 50% of that. So we're right, running about 50% of what we're doing.
Okay.
It's not bad. We had a conference call the end of March with the United States Department of Transportation, and they were very adamant about these local carriers. We're paying you, we want you to continue to fly. Even if the airplanes are empty, the people that sell fuel need to sell fuel, the pilots need to be paid, and we're paying you. And so we flew every day, and Air Choice One has flown every day. There's been some empty flights, there's been some with one or two on it. Now, today we had 8 people going to Atlanta. So the Atlanta flight's gonna come back faster, I think, than the St. Louis, but we've got the issue in St. Louis. They're playing baseball, but they're not letting us see it.
See it, yeah.
So that hamstrings the St. Louis side. The interesting thing, and the gentleman that you saw me with at breakfast this morning, Steve, is another commuter airline. We are at that point where every 2 or 4 years, we go through a selection process. And so the order was released last week from the Department of Transportation. And we have until I think it's the 29th of October for interested parties to submit a bid to provide service to Jackson-Madison County. We had the group this morning, and I won't mention names, but the group this morning was our number two choice the last time. So the guy this morning said, Steve, I'm motivated. And that translates into a lot of different things. However, I think last time we had 8 different carriers come to us and give us ideas on what we could do. But at that time in the Air Choice One saga, we were only 2 years in with them. Now we're 6 years in with them. Okay. So now what we've got to look at is their financial health, where we think they're going. What have they done for us in the last 2 years? Is that a trend? Are they going to continue to support us, or are they going to back off a little bit, try to ride the rocking chair? A lot of moving parts when you every 2 years have to reselect a carrier.
Wow.
We don't know, and I would have really thought we had a shot at jet service before the virus came, because our numbers were good, our people were good. We had a lot of interest. So now with all of the air travel down, I think 30 to 50% is normal. Some markets may be back up to 60 or 70%. As we look forward, I don't know if this selection process will warrant. I'm hoping it'll warrant bigger aircraft. That's one of the things that we've needed, especially on the Atlanta flight, is we've needed the ability to put more people into Atlanta on a daily basis. It's hard to do that with a caravan. It's very economical, but it's hard to do that with a caravan.
Okay.
I would not be against an aircraft of the same size that was faster, that made multiple trips to Atlanta, and even one less flight a day to St. Louis, especially.
What's going to be the timetable on this bid or process?
We'll make our recommendation to the Department of Transportation by Christmas.
Okay.
So we're in the process now forming a committee. We'll get with the chamber. We'll try to figure out which way we go, and we'll have all of the bids in by October 29th, and then we'll start asking them in for interviews.
See, we're going to continue this conversation in just a moment. Steve Smith is with us. He's the executive director of the Airport Authority here in Jackson and Madison County and McKellar-Sykes Regional Airport. We're going to take this break, and we welcome once again the very talented Jeremy Tubbs and Jenna McLean.
Willow, weep for me. Willow, weep for me. Bend your branches green along the stream that runs to sea. Listen to my plea, hear me, willow, and weep for me. Gone my lover's dream, lovely summer dream. Gone and left me here to weep my tears and cover me. When the shadows fall, hear me, willow, and weep for me. Whisper to the wind and say, my love is and leave my heart a breaking and making a moan. Murmur to the night to hide her starry light, so none will find me sighing and crying all alone. ground and cover me when the shadows fall. Hear me, willow and reed.
Tired of internet that leaves you waiting and monitoring your usage with extra fees? Switch to EPlus Broadband from the Jackson Energy Authority for fiber optic internet with the fastest speeds to keep everyone connected. Enjoy being online as much as you want without worrying about extra fees or data usage limits. Perfect for when you need to download and upload large files, stream videos, or use your favorite video conferencing app. EPlus Broadband, fastest internet, no data caps, no slowdowns, no worries. The JEA app. With it, you may view the electric outage map, report electric outages, receive electric outage alerts, view your current account information in real time. You can even make a payment with one click. Name, account number, you're in. Convenient access with the free JEA app, keeping you connected with JEA today.
Welcome back to Six in the City. Steve Bowers, Cassandra Fuller with you. We will welcome back General McLean, Jeremy Tubbs, coming up before we get away. But I wanted to continue our conversation with Steve Smith, who's the Executive Director of the Jackson-Madison County Airport Authority, McKellar-Sykes Regional Airport. We're talking about the carrier, and that decision will be made toward the end of the year. So there's a possibility there could be a different carrier here.
There is that possibility. There is. And let me say something real quick.
Sure.
That girl can sing.
She's good.
She can sing.
Yeah, this is gone quickly from Jeremy Tubbs and Jenna McLean to Jenna McLean with Jeremy Tubbs.
On the side. Yeah, I mean he's a decent guitar player, but I mean they're a dime a dozen, right?
Yeah, he's doing it just right. He's got Scotty Moore with Elvis. It all takes it all
right
to work, but
you're exactly
there you
right
go.
Steve, this summer
you
guys offered the flight to Florida. So with the new carrier, is that going to be an option that's going to be available?
I think it will be. We discussed with the representative that was in today. We discussed multi-destinations, things that we've kind of gotten used to. And we also discussed some of the things we learned going to Destin. One of the carriers that we're talking to, and again, remember, the city, the county, the airport makes absolutely no money out of the airline. The Department of Transportation funds the airline, Essential Air Service, with overflight fees, and that are fees that foreign carriers pay the United States government to fly in our borders, and that's what funds the Essential Air Service.
Wow.
So when we look at who makes the decision, the Department of Transportation makes the decision. It's not always the low bidder.
Okay.
And that sometimes it's good to know. Our Chamber of Commerce people will have a big influence in this. Our two mayors will have a big influence in this. And the chairman of our board and a board of directors, James Ross is our chair this year, and they will have an influence also. So it's all of these entities working together. They'll have an influence. And in years past, sometimes the choice is made and we scratch our head when it comes from Washington, but inevitably it's been a decent choice for us over the last 12 years that I've been here. We've struggled with some bad choices, But we're not dissatisfied at all with Air Choice One. They've flown every day. Their completion rate's 90%, 95%. Their on-time rate's 99%. The thing that we're looking for is there more frequency? Is there more capacity out there somewhere? No, we're looking.
Steve, give us an update on what all is going on at the airport as far as, I know your commercial, you're talking about your not a commercial business, but your industrial business and everything else.
Business.
You made some improvements out there as well, right?
Well, we have. We're in the last week of a construction project that we have sealed almost 200 square feet of cracks. Anybody that has this much asphalt and, you know, they can tell you that down at the highway department, there's going to be issues with it. And some of this pavement's 30 years old. So we've been sealing cracks this summer. We've been putting a new type sealer on the asphalt, not unlike what you put on your driveway, to help the elasticity and help it. And then we're going through a marking project. All the runways, the taxiways, the numbers, the threshold bars, all of that. We've hydro cleaned them all. And we've had a real issue, guys, with that over the last 2 years because we've had so much rain. That we've actually had algae growing on the white paint on the runway.
Oh, wow.
Our airplanes land on the runways, but not necessarily on the white parts. And so we tried to go in and scrub it off, and so much of it was just impossible. So we brought a big truck in that hydro washed it and cleaned all the paint off. And so we've started again. This time, I'm hoping they're using a little better paint. But it will
keep that white clean.
Yes, it is. So we're hoping that she'll have a fresh coat of paint. She'll look good, especially from the air. We'll be doing some aerial shots. We'll make sure that you guys get something if you can use it for background or that you need a new aerial shot of the airport. We'll make sure you get that. But all that's coming. We're doing a new airport layout plan. That's in the works. We're working on that too. We're like any other county entity. We had a lot of plans. They were changed by the funding on the county and city level this time. We were able to fund an economic development grant that we had gotten earlier in the year, about a $900,000 grant that is almost all of it is state. I think 5% of it city, 5% of it's county. We've begun now to start the planning process on that. We have a hangar that we built with grant money, guys, about 3 years ago. We spent almost $1 million in building this hangar. It's just a beautiful hangar. But because of grant restrictions, it had no office space and it's been hard to lease. So the economic development grant is allowing us to build about 2,000 square foot of office space and an entrance on this hangar. And we already have a tenant. So we're working toward getting that project started as well.
So you all think about coming back and maybe let's do a dialogue. There are a lot of things we ought to get into. We need a little more time, if that's okay.
Yeah, anytime. Let me know.
We'll get that book soon. Good to have you with us.
It's good to be here again. Thank you, Cassandra. Thank you, Steve.
Thank you so very much. We'll be right back with more as we continue this 6 in the City.
Roll over. Can't high five. All
right. When you adopt a shelter pet, you discover all the things that make them unique.
And your mother and
fur. I am totally a hot person. Right, guys? Thanks for being honest. They're a little bit of a lot of things, but they're all pure love. Adopt pure love at theshelterpetproject.org.
As we all take care and precautions, practicing social distancing with more time at home, we may find ourselves using more broadband too, relying on internet, television, and telephone services to stay connected to work, school, and family. JA is working hard to keep our customers, employees, and families safe while bringing vital services during this time, keeping you connected to the essential broadband services Jackson's homes and businesses depend on is one thing you can count on at JA today.
Here you go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Never gonna let you go. Never gonna let you go.
Steve Bowers and Cassandra Fuller welcoming you back to Six in the City. Thanks to all of our guests and appreciate the insights, all the work that's underway with Make-A-Wish and Matt Marshall in with the device drive for the United Way of Western Sea. Be sure to check that out. An opportunity to talk to Steve Smith and to introduce our musical guest as well. And we'll be right back to that.
Lots of great things going on in there.
A lot of exciting things going on in this community. Yeah. Now, we've got a change coming at our customer center on MLK with the Jackson Energy Authority. Cassandra, what's happening there?
We actually do. They're making a few renovations. And so they're going to need to close on Thursday, the 24th, and Friday, the 25th. And this is just going to affect the Martin Luther King Jr. location, which is what we call our Midtown location. So it's just the lobby that's going to be closed. The drive-through will still be open, and then the kiosk will still be open. But they're getting a little maintenance, little renovation work done. So they need both days to take
care. Now, how are the kiosks going? We've got kiosks out at Food Giant, both Food Giant now.
We do. We've got two brand new kiosks. They're out at both Food Giant locations, one out by the ballpark and the one south. You walk in, they're not labeled JEA, they're labeled PaySite, but there is a JEA advertising video on there. So all you do is you just go in, you can make your payment on that kiosk, and it's easy to do.
Okay, perfect. Well, it's good to see you. You know, always good to work with you. Well, we're going to let these folks close it out. We're excited that she's joined us. Jenna McLean has joined the faculty of the University of Memphis Lambeth, and Jeremy Tubbs, and all this. What an exciting development for the program. And so, folks, we appreciate the opportunity to talk with you. Glad to have you both with us and have this music program in the city of Jackson. So we're going to let y'all close out this show. We'll hope to see you soon for Studio 6.
Thanks, Steve. We are going to do a little show at the Hub City Deli on Saturday night now.
Okay. Okay. So, well, great.
Starting at 6 o'clock. So.
Okay.
6 o'clock. Miss Cassandra. All right.
Sometimes I go out by myself and I look across the water and I think of all the things what you're doing, and in my head I paint a picture. Well, since I've come on home, well, my body's been a mess, and I miss your ginger hair and the way you like to dress. Won't you come on over? Stop making a fool out of me. Why don't you come on over, Valerie? Did you have to go? Put your house on up for sale. Did you get a good lawyer? Hope you didn't catch a 10. Hope you found the right man who fixed it for you. Are you shopping anywhere? Change the color of your hair. Are you busy? And did you have to pay that fine? You were dodging all the time. Are you still dizzy? Well, since I've come home, well, my body's been a mess, and I miss your ginger hair and the way you like to dress. Won't you come on over? Stop making a fool out of me. Why don't you come on over?